فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. وإن شرح الكتاب جلباب المرأة المسلمة written by الشيخ العلامة محمد ناصر الدين الألباني رحمه الله. We were in the tafsir of the ayah وَقُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنَاتِ يَغْضُضْنَ مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِنَّ وَيَحْفَظْنَ فُرُوجَهُنَّ وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ إِلَّا مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَلِيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جُيُوبِهِنَّ. Allah then says, وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ. And the women should not reveal their adornment and their beauty. وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ. That the women should not, they should not reveal and they should not show their beauty. إِلَّا لِبُعُولَتِهِنَّ, except to their husbands. The word bu'ula, we took yesterday, the word bu'ula means the husband. So the woman is allowed for the husband to see her. The husband is allowed to not only see her without her hijab, he has an exclusive right to see every part of her body. And she also has the right to see every part of his body. And this is unique to the husband and wife only. There is no other man that can see the woman's entirety. He can see every part of her body other than her husband. And there is no woman that can see a man's entire aura except his wife. She is the only one who is entitled to see it. So Allah started with that one. He said, وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ, that they should not reveal their beauty, إِلَّا لِبُعُولَتِهِنَّ, except their husbands. They should not show it except to their husbands. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, all their fathers, إِلَّا لِبُعُولَتِهِنَّ أَوْ أَبَائِهِنَّ. The other person she's allowed to show her beauty to is her father. And as we said yesterday, the beauty that she can show her father is her neck, her face, her hair, her hands, and her 2 feet. Her father can see that. When she puts her abaya on, what's left is what her father can see. And the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the father, because he's the second in power after the husband. When a woman gets married, her husband takes more rights than her father. So the husband was mentioned first. And because he has more rights, it allows him to have more things between him and his wife. Meaning there's things he can see that no other person can see. So the husband was mentioned first. Or the father. And the father here doesn't just mean her dad. It also means her granddad. And her granddad, her dad's dad, and her dad's dad's dad. The same is her. Anyone who goes above her father, that's where he enters. And the same is the father of her mother. He's also a father for her. وَإِنْ عَلَىٰ, even if he goes up, it's her father. أَوْ آبَائِهِنَّ, أَوْ آبَائِ بُعُولَتِهِنَّ, or their husband's father. If a woman is married, the next person who can see her beauty is her husband's father. She also can take her hijab off. And he is allowed to see what her father can see. And her granddads can also see. Or their sons. The son here is the child that she has had with her husband. her sons here, you can also see her. You can see their mother. The same is what they can see that the father can see. And her husband's father can see. Her neck, her face, her hair, her two hands, and you can see her two feet. That's what the son can see from his mother. Good. Here, when we say the son, any child that comes from the son is her son. If a son gives birth to a son, and gives birth to a son, well, in nazar, however far it goes, that's also her sons. So if her son gives birth to a boy, and that boy gives birth to a boy, and she's a grandmother, her grandson is like her son. Okay? Or their husband's son. So if her husband was previously married, and he has children, and he's got sons, she's also allowed to show her beauty to her husband's son. Meaning it's not a child that she's had with him. This is not her son. It's her husband's son. Or she's in a polygamous relationship, and her husband is married to another woman, and he has from that other woman a son. You can see that son. That son can see your hair, your face, your two palms, and he can also see your two foot. So her husband's son. Or their brothers, the sister, her brother. Whether that brother is, the other person we see her beauty is who? Her brother. Her brother here can be the one who has the same mother and father as her, or it can be the one who has the same mother with her, or it can be the one that has the same father with her, it doesn't matter. Her brother here is any of those three. Same father and mother, same father, it doesn't matter. But not cousins. Not cousins. Very good. All their brothers, all their brothers' sons, her nephews. She's allowed to show her beauty to her brothers' sons. They also can see it. Again, her brother can be her full brother, can be half brother. Half brother meaning same mom, only same dad. It doesn't matter. The child, the boy that he has is what? That boy that he has, she can go and she take her hijab off. Very good. Or their sister's son. Meaning, your nephew from your sister's side. So your sister's son. Before we spoke about the brother's son, your sister's son is also your what? Your what to her? And when you're what to him? You are like a mother to him. You're his khala. You're his maternal auntie. So you're entitled, you are allowed to see him. For him to see you, your beauty. Like Somalis, they call her Habar Yar. The reason why they call her Habar Yar, Habar means mother. Yar means small mother. The maternal auntie is like a small mom. She's like your small mom. So that boy is allowed to see her beauty. All their women. Nisa'ihinna here is the women. Women are allowed to see other women. And there are two views regarding what they can see. As I said before, one view holds that the women's awrah between each other is like the awrah of a man to another man. Between the navel to the knees. That's one view. That's the awrah to a woman to another woman. Second view is what? That the awrah for a woman to another woman is what we mentioned. When she's at home, what she wears. Her abaya, her hands, her neck, her face, and her hair is what it is. That's the strongest, that's the qawl al-jumhur, the view of the majority of the ulama. So a woman can see another woman. As long as this woman is not a fasiqa. She's not a evil individual woman who, when she looks at this woman, she's not going to go out and she's not going to describe it to the man. The Prophet said, لا تباشر المرأة المرأة. A woman should not describe another woman to her husband. فتنعتها لزوجها كان ينظر إليها, so that as if he is looking at her. So the hadith here tells us لا تباشر المرأة. A woman should not describe another woman to her husband, so that he's been described this woman so much so that as though he's looking at her. The fuqaha, they took a benefit from this hadith. What is the benefit that they took from it? That as much as it's prohibited to look at a woman, you can't look at a woman's aura, you can't read novels and stories that are vivid in their description, that describe the thoughts into your brain and bring it to your brain. Huh? What was that book that everybody was reading again? Very filthy book. 90 Shades or something. Oh. Huh?
50 Shades of Grey.
50 Shades of Grey. So this book is not a... You can't see anything. If you open it, you're not going to see any pictures in it. Is there pictures in it? No. There's no pictures in the book. But when you read the book, the description... I never read it. But the book described and is vivid in its description. So, vivid in its description. And then the ulama took from that, you're not allowed to do that. Some people love reading that stuff. Some sisters, they read, they say, oh, I'm not watching a haram movie. No, I'm not watching, what do you call it? She's reading all day. She says, I don't watch movies. But she reads novels that are haram. They read novels which are haram. And it says things that are, so the ulama took from that. Because you're now being, the description has been brought to your head. It's haram. Also, some people say, I was told to lower my gaze from directly a woman. Sah? If I see a woman, I was told to lower my gaze. This, on the other hand, is a picture of a woman. She's not the real woman. And when the Prophet was speaking about not looking at a woman, he was talking about directly looking at her, not looking at her. I'm not looking at her directly. This is through a wasita, it's through a camera. It's really, really not her. So, Mary, the scholars, they said, if description is haram, then video is worse than it. Are you with me? The fuqaha and the scholars, they brought that out of it. Very good. Oh, ma malakat aymanuhunna. Another people, a person who can see the woman's beauty, are those that their right hand possesses. If a woman has a slave in the house, she's allowed to take her hijab off in front of a slave boy. Some of the ulama, they say, no, what it means is that she can take her hijab off in front of a slave girl. وَهَذَا خَطَأ. That's wrong. And that's not what the ayah means. The ayah is talking about a slave boy. That the woman is allowed to take her hijab off in front of her slave boy. And the evidence for that is the famous hadith of Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha. Fatima, she had a slave boy at her house, and the Prophet came one day to visit her. And when he came to visit her, alayhi salatu wasalam, what Fatima did was that she tried to cover up. Slave boy was there, she tried to cover up from him. So whenever she covered up, because she didn't have enough clothing, whenever she covered her upper part of her body, her face and onwards, her legs would show. And when she would cover her legs, her face would show. So the Prophet saw her struggling. And then the Prophet said to Fatima, Fatima, there is no harm on you. There's not a problem on you in this regard. There isn't. He said to her, alayhi salatu wasalam, there's no harm on you, for verily the only people here is your father and your slave boy. In other words, meaning, it's not something you need to worry about. So this hadith shows that if a woman has a slave boy, she can also she could also take a hijab off in front of him. أو ما ملكت أيمانهن. Also, أو التابعين غير أولي الإربة من الرجال. This mentions the other people who see the tabi'in among men who do not have desire. What does this mean? It means any individual who is he's feeble-minded. His mind is not complete. It's an individual who doesn't realize if he sat with women, there's nothing he comes to his mind. He's a man who doesn't have no sexual drive to go to women. He has none of that. وَلِذَلِكَ ابْنَ عَبَّاسٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ He said, this is the kind of person who has no desires. It's the man which they refer to the ulama as عِلِّيم. عِلِّيم means what? It's a man who doesn't have any sexual drive. He doesn't feel any drive towards a woman in any way, form or shape. There was a man at the time of the Prophet ﷺ who used to enter onto the Prophet's wives. He used to enter onto the Prophet's family ﷺ. And they used to consider him to be from one of those men who had no desires. And they wouldn't kick him out of the gathering, they wouldn't wear the hijab in front of him. So one day, as he was sitting with them, he was describing a woman. He started to describe a woman. He was like with four shirols. When she walks on four. And when she walks away, she does with eight, describing her body parts and how she is. Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered whilst he was saying that. And then the Messenger said, أَلَا أَرَى هَذَا يَعْلَمُ مَا هَا هُنَا لَا يَدْخُلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ The Prophet said, Lo, I think this person knows what it is about the affairs of women. This man has knowledge of women's issues. There's something there. He's not fully feeble-minded. And he's not fully a man who has no desires. And then the Prophet said he should never enter onto you. Never let this individual enter onto you guys. So there was something that the Prophet sensed from him that there was a sexual drive in him. So if a man has he's absent-minded, where if he sits with men or if he sits with women, if he sits with children, this is for him is all the same. Then women are allowed to take their hijab in front of him. Because he doesn't know anything. These are ones Allah referring to here. أَوِ التَّابِعِينَ غَيْرِ أُولِي الْإِرْبَةِ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ أَوِ الطِّفْلِ الَّذِينَ لَمْ يَظْهَرُوا عَلَى عَوْرَاتِ النِّسَاءِ And the next ones are, or children who are not aware of the nakedness of women. أَوِ الطِّفْلِ It's children الَّذِينَ لَمْ يَظْهَرُوا عَلَى عَوْرَاتِ النِّسَاءِ Who are not aware of the nakedness of women. This is something we have to really ponder now. Especially nowadays, you think 9-year-old kids are normal? No. A 9-year-old kid and a 10-year-old kid is not necessarily how they were before, the innocency that was there. So you can't take this and say, أَوَ الطِّفْلِ الَّذِينَ لَمْ يَظْهَرُوا عَلَى عَوْرَاتِ النِّسَاءِ Because what the condition the ayah mentioned is what? أَوَ الطِّفْلِ It is the child, the one who لَمْ يَظْهَرُوا عَلَى عَوْرَاتِ النِّسَاءِ He doesn't observe, he doesn't look at the nakedness of women. Meaning for him, again, he's an individual who, whether she's wearing clothes or not, for him, it doesn't spark anything to his mind. He doesn't realize what's happening here. Are you with me? Okay? You have to observe that. Because nowadays, our kids, as I said to you before, I know a kid who's 12 years of age and he has a girlfriend. He's 12. Has a girlfriend, he's got a mobile phone, he's got a girlfriend, he sells drugs in the area, he's 12 years of age. So if you sit down with a lot of young kids and you speak to them, they'll tell you. Reason is because what's been taught in school, what they watch on television, and the things that they read, and matters like that. If you sit with your children and you speak with them, you see they know a lot, because they have teachers outside that are teaching them. Very good. The woman is not allowed to show any of those. All those which we mentioned in the ayah now are those who she's allowed to show her awrah to. Anyone other than those, the ayah did not mention. Then Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا يَضْرِبْنَا بِأَرْجُلِهِنَّ لِيُعْلَمَ مَا يُخْفِينَ مِنْ زِينَتِهِنَّ. Allah then says, and let them, meaning the women, not stamp their feet, meaning hit their feet on the ground, so they reveal what they are hiding of their adornment. Back at those times, the women used to wear something called al-khalkhal. And it's, what's it called? Lead bracelets. Is that right?
Anklet.
Huh?
Anklet.
They're called anklets.
Yeah.
Bracelets is always the arm, hand, right? So this is what it's like, small and say lead bracelet, right? Ala kulli hal is what the woman is the lead, is ankle bracelet.
Anklet.
It's the anklet that the women put on. What they used to do before Islam, the Jahiliyyah, was that the woman would put it on and she would walk in front of the men and it would make noise. That noise that it makes, that clutch, clutch, where it hits each other, is what she wants. She's doing that to get attention. She's doing that to receive what? To receive attention from the men. So she walks past a group of men. They weren't looking, they just look, and they say, this is the woman who's wearing the khalqal she's got in her leg. So they look at her, she gets attention. The ulama took from this, that this is anything that a woman does that will bring men's attention towards her. Anything she does. Because the illah why this is prohibited is the asr is the woman, she's tasattur, she hides herself. She doesn't pull any attention. Anything that she does, or anything that she brings about, until the day of judgment, whatever it may be, anything that she wears or she puts on or she does, that has what? That has noise, or it has, of course, fragrance. There's a specific hadith for that. That she puts a fragrance on, and you smell it after she's long gone. She's gone. She's gone. It's fully gone. And you know this perfume is a female's perfume. It's not permissible. It's not permissible. So doing this, it goes against the concept of what hijab is, right? It goes against hijab. So a woman, if a woman has gold on, are you with me? She'll be very careful. So she shouldn't reveal what they hide from their adornment. وَلَا يَضْرِبْنَا And they should not stamp their feet بِأَرْجُلِهِنَّ لِيُعْلَمَ So that the people can know, so they can reveal مَا يُخْفِينَ مِنْ زِينَتِهِنَّ The beauty in which they are hiding, the beauty they hide. They're bringing it out in the open so people can see it. Allah then says, وَتُوبُوا And all of you beg Allah and repent to Him. وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ Turn and in repentance to Allah. جميعاً all of you أيها المؤمنون أو believers لعلكم تفلحون لكي تفلحون so that you may find success so you may attain through your repentance and asking for forgiveness you may receive from it forgiveness then Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani he brought the ayah وقوله تعالى في سورة الأحزاب The second ayah that the author brings for the first condition was what? So what's the chapter first? What's this? What's the first condition that the Shaykh Rahimahullah brings? Isti'abu jami'i al-badari illa mastuthniya. That the woman has to fully, her outer garment, it should fully what? The outer garment worn in public must cover all of the body except the face and the hands according to the view of Shaykh. Nasir rahimahullah. So for this chapter, all of this time, the ayah that we were taking through last week, yesterday, was the first evidence. Then the Shaykh moves on to وَقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى and the statement of Allah في سورة الأحزاب in سورة الأحزاب الآية the ayah which is ayah 59 where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he says يا أيها النبي يا أيها النبي O Prophet of Allah قل لأزواجك say to your wives Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to the Prophet he says to him oh ya ayyuhan nabi oh prophet of allah allah is talking to him nabi allah muhammad qul say li azwajika to your wives and this is a tarbiyah and a way which allah is teaching us that when you give da'wah it starts at home the first people you give da'wah to is who your family member and you educate your own family member you teach them The ulama, they say, either you teach your wife and you educate her with the religion, or if you feel that you're unable to do so, maybe because you don't have the knowledge, or maybe that you don't have the time to do so, then you facilitate for her an environment and a place where she can study. You facilitate for her an environment and a place in which she can study. As Allah says to the Prophet here, Command your wife first to wear hijab. And tell your wife that she has to come up. Then Allah said to him, وَبَنَاتِكَ And your daughters. Tell your daughters, first of all your wife. Tell your wives, all of them cover up. وَبَنَاتِكَ And your what? And your daughters. Command your daughters to cover up. To the person, the Prophet wasn't commanded to go to anybody else's daughters. Or anybody else's wives, the first wife that he starts with is his own. And the first daughters that he starts with is his own daughters. وَنِسَاءِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ And then he's told to go to the wider community. The wider community here is وَنِسَاءِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ And the believing women. The person goes to the believing women and he commands them. The Prophet was told, then inform the believing women about the ruling of what? يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ The word يُدْنِينَ is a خَبَرٌ بِمَعْنَى الطَّلَبِ يُدْنِينَ here, the way it's written is like a statement. It's saying يُدْنِينَ, they cover. It's like you're mentioning that the women cover themselves with their jilbab. But what's meant by it is a command, which is the scholars call it خبر بمعنى أمر بمعنى طلب أما خبرية لفظا طلبية المعنى. The wording here is خبر. It's like when your parents say you're going to go to school. They didn't say to go to school. They said to you, you're going to go to school. There's a difference between the two. The first one is a statement. But within that statement, it's a what? It's a command. And Allah uses that subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. Allah says, يُدْنِينَ They will throw. Idna means that the woman, she flows the hijab off. يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَ Jilbab is what is worn on top of the khimar on the niqab. Once the woman wears the khimar, and then she wears the niqab, she then throws on herself the jilbab. So the jilbab is what's on top. Allah says, يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ Abdullah ibn Abbas said something very powerful here. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, Ibn Kathir brings this in his tafsir. That Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, أَمَرَ اللَّهُ نِسَاءَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ Allah commanded the believing women. إِذَا خَرَجْنَا مِنْ بُيُوتِهِنَّ If they leave their houses and they go out, في حاجتهم But they have to go for a reason. Because if you look at this ayah, إِلَى النَّبِي قُلْ لِأَزْوَاجِكَ If you look at what context is in, the verses before that Allah says to the women, وَقَرْنَا فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَا تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ أُولَى That the women should stay at home and that they should not what? They should not come out like the pre-Islamic women would come out. That the woman should stay at home. So Ibn Abbas here is saying that Allah commanded the believing women that when they come out of their houses for a reason, for a need, there is a hajjah. There's something that's bringing her out of the house. It's not like, oh, it's so hot inside. I need a fresh air. It's not a hajjah. Or I'm chilling with my friends. Alright? I'm chilling. I'm coaching with my friends. No. The woman, she has to what? She has to stay at home, aslan. But when she comes out, there has to be fi hajat. There has to be a need. So he said, Allah commanded the believing women that when they come out of their houses for a reason, أَن يُغَطِّينَ وُجُوهُهُنَّ مِن فَوْقِ رُؤُوسِهِنَّ بِالْجَلَابِيبِ أَمَا بِالْجِلْبَابِ, sorry. That when they come out of their houses for a reason, for a need, أَن يُغَطِّينَ وُجُوهُهُنَّ, Ibn Abbas says that they cover their faces, مِن فَوْقِ رُؤُوسِهِنَّ, over their heads, بِالْجِلْبَابِ, with the jilbab. So they cover their faces from top of their head with the jilbab. Ibn Abbas, that's what he said, it means yudnina alayhimna bijalabibina. So the woman's coming out of her house, and the reason why she's leaving her house is what? There is an hajj and a need that she has. So what's needed upon her here, that's commanded here, based on the tafsir of the Tarjuman of Quran, Ibn Abbas, is that is what? Ayyuhaddina wujuhahunna, that they cover their faces, bifokir usihina, from high above with the jilbab, bil jilbab. Allah then says, Subhanahu wa Taala, "Dalika adna." Where does that dalika go back to? Ayil idna, that hijab, covering your face, covering your body parts. That idna that you're coming with, dalika, that idna is adna an yu'rafna fala yudayn. What does it mean, adna an yu'rafna? This is more befitting for people to recognize you. To recognize your what? To recognize that you are two things. Annahunna hara'ir, that you're not slaves. Because the slaves, when it comes to hijab, are different from the free women. And the second one is that you recognize that you're an afifat. You're a chaste woman. With the jilbab, you're recognized you're a chaste woman. وَلِذَلِكَ Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, what did he say? ذَلِكَ أَنَّا يُعْرَفْنَا أَيْ إِذَا فَعَلْنَا ذَلِكَ. If the women, they do the idna, the Abbas mentioning covering their face and covering their hands and covering their whole body parts. إِذَا فَعَلْنَا ذَلِكَ, if they do that, عُرِفْنَا, they will be known أَنَّهُنَّ حَرَائِرْ, that they are free women. لَيْسَ بِإِمَائِرْ, that she's not a slave. وَلَا عَوَاهِرْ, and she's not a prostitute. She's recognized. She's a woman who's dressed in modesty. So two things are known, that this woman is not a slave. And the ahkam of the sharia is different from the slave. The slave doesn't have to cover like the free woman has to. Are you with me? And also that they are wala awahib, and they are also not prostitutes. Pay attention here now. There's a qissa Ibn Kathir mentions in this tafsir of this ayah in Nabi Bulli as well, if you go back to the tafsir. There's a what? There's a story he mentions that there were fusaq in Medina. There were people who were fasiqin, who were in Medina, and what they would do is they would, at night time, if the women were walking in Medina, they would do bad things to them. But they would only do it to the women who were what? Who were not wearing hijab properly. And the women that were covered and that were fully wearing the jalabib, that were making sure that their body parts are covered, what did he do? The fasiq would leave her alone.